If you want to pump your body and expand your mind, there's only one place to go. Mind Pump. Mind Pump. With your hosts, Sal DiStefano, Adam Schaefer, and Justin Andrews.
In this episode of Mind Pump, for the first 12 minutes, we have our intro where me, Adam, and Justin have some fun conversation.
First, we riff.
Adam talks about his new Organifi.
I have it for you right now, too. The super wife came through and she sent it over to me, so I'm going to read it off right now.
So, all right, so this is an Organifi brownie recipe. Do it.
Yeah, this is it. So it's 2 scoops of the Organifi vanilla protein, 2 tablespoons of unsweetened cocoa, 1/2 cup melted peanut butter, 3 bananas, the browner the better. Optional, we did this, crushed walnuts at the bottom of the pan. So optional, also 1/4 cup walnuts added to the mix. So we put a little bit of walnuts in the mix. We made a little bread at the bottom, and then we used one of those. What do you call those little tinfoil pie-looking dishes? You
know, I think that's
pie
it.
Plate.
Pie plate.
Pie plate.
Just like a tinfoil one, right? Whatever you call those.
And then you bake it?
Yep, and then you bake it.
Excellent. So they
got,
are-
I got you guys.
Organifi is one of our sponsors. If you go to OrganifiShop.com, enter the code MindPump, you'll get 20% off pretty much anything. We also talk about how Adam got Katrina to cook- the way that he likes.
Oh, fuck.
And he revealed that.
Ninja.
Hopefully she still does.
Katrina, I know you're listening to the episode.
I might have just fucked
myself. Wait till you hear this one.
Me, Justin, and Doug like you the way you are. You don't got to change for
us. You're a great cook.
We also talk about our Pajaro Dunes retreat, where we actually went off and created new content, for written content for online, so we can get more people introduced to Mind Pump. I also mentioned Thrive Market in this episode. I know the holidays are coming up. With Thrive Market, when you enroll and get yourself a membership, they will give a free membership to a family in need. Now, that membership normally costs something like, I don't know, like $30 or $40 a year. Well, check this out. If you go to thrivemarket.com/mindpump, you'll get 1 month free membership, plus free shipping on $49 or more, plus $20 off the first 3 orders of $49 or more. So you get hooked up fat.
And you're helping people out.
Then we get into the questions. The first question was, what are our thoughts about sleeping on the floor versus sleeping in a bed? Isn't this analogous to wearing shoes versus barefoot walking?
This dude just got kicked out of his house.
I was just going to say
like
that.
A terrible idea. Yeah.
I was just going to say
this
that.
Am I doing it right?
Tell me I'm going to be okay, Mind Pump.
The next question was, how to
treat this as a workout.
What is our response to the health at every size movement? Is this a good movement? Is it a bad movement? Or is it like Adam says, yes and no? The next question was,
I'm amoeba sized.
Somebody's asking us if they should remain a personal trainer or if they should move up the ladder.
That's Tony.
And manage a big box gym. And finally, how is it possible to be vegan and have a bigger ass than Justin?
Impossible.
That's actually impossible. Yeah. Although we do talk about glute.
I eat vegans.
We talk about glute building strategies in this episode. And I do mention the Build Your Butt bundle. So what the bundle is it takes 2 of our most popular programs, MAPS Anabolic, MAPS Aesthetic, and it includes a modification for people who have trouble feeling their glutes when they do those great glute exercises like squats and lunges and deadlifts. It's a pretty revolutionary program. We put it all together, and then we discounted it at something like 25% off. If you want to build your glutes and you want to build your whole body, but your glutes in particular, the Build Your Butt bundle is phenomenal. It is for you. It's all planned out. Exercise demos, workout blueprints, everything you need to build your butt. You can find it at mindpumpmedia.com.
All right. It's t-shirt time.
T-shirt time.
Give them to him, Doug.
All right. We got 17 reviews this last week, so we're giving out 5
that's
shirts.
Not too bad. Not too bad.
Not
I like
too
that.
Bad at all.
Let's hear them.
All right. We got Jay Willie's 2979, BAM 03087. Bberry 93, Crane Guy 32,
like that guy.
Rachel Ann 85. All of you are winners. Send the name I just read to iTunes@mindpumpmedia.com. Send your shirt size, your shipping address, and we'll get that right out to you.
That's right. We got you fitted. We were in a rush to get over there. She said they weren't ready, and there were some things I needed to change with the recipe. So she did. Fucking bomb.
What did you do? What did you mix? How's it work? What's going on?
I don't know. Bro, I don't fucking do that. The recipe is on Organifi. So
what is it called?
It's the brownie. It's the brownie. It has, okay, bananas. It has the protein powder from Organifi. It's got walnuts. It's got cocoa powder and something else.
Avocado.
No.
He's all in brownie mix.
Yeah. No.
Brownie mix. Yeah. From Betty Crocker. Yeah.
No, it's all it's
you
it's
take
all,
that
it's all,
and you sprinkle
it's
on
all gluten free and all it's all super
wow.
It's bomb. But she tweaks some things. So what I'll do for our listeners that are listening right now, in case Doug can't find the recipe, because I don't know for sure if Katrina totally tweaked it herself or not. But this has been one of my favorite recipes. It's really light.
I'm so upset I haven't tried anything.
And even though it's a brownie, it has a banana walnutty taste with just a hint of that the chocolate cocoa. Oh, dude, and it's just, man. This is probably one of my favorite treats that we've made so far.
You got to bring that to the holiday parties, dude.
No, we will. This
are we going to have a holiday party, by the way? Are we doing anything?
A mind pump holiday?
Well, we got staff now.
Holiday party.
We didn't have staff last year.
I didn't even think
as long as there's eggnog, I'm there.
We should talk about doing something for everybody.
Got to get some nog.
What do you guys want to do for everybody?
I was thinking about taking them to Arby's.
Arby's?
Take
is there one that still exists?
Let's take them to Chili's.
If we were
that
good,
one in near Hillsdale?
If we were really good, if we were really good leaders, we should think of individual things for each one of them.
I'm not gonna see now that you said that
so bad
it's on air.
Gifts.
Now we have to do it. I don't think so.
That's
what
not
I
true.
Think,
we can just give everyone a bonus, dude. Everybody be fucking just happy.
Yeah, man. Keep it simple.
Yeah, give me
that's
a
what
bonus.
I would want. Like,
how about if we give ourselves
time.
A Christmas bonus? Yeah. Okay, because I need to stop with the fucking Jetta.
Secret
the light came on.
Santa gave me a secret bonus.
Some light came on my car today.
What?
Oh no.
I don't know what it was. It was red.
I was just talking.
It was a red light.
I was just talking to Katrina about trading the Denali.
And I looked it up, and it's like, if you see this red light pop up, you need to bring your car in immediately.
It's going to explode.
So you know what I did?
What?
I turned the car off, turned it back on. The light was gone.
Disappeared.
I fixed it.
You did it.
I fixed the light. So, but I think it's, you know how you listen to your body signals? You know, I talk about intuitive eating all the time. You got to listen to your body signals. And if you don't listen, the signals get louder until it yells at you.
Yeah.
My car
is yelling at you.
Is not yet.
It's whispering.
But little by little, I'm getting the, you know, yeah, you got to do something about this,
hey,
buddy.
Hey, man.
So,
you're hurting me.
If you're listening right now, MAPS program's on sale.
Yeah.
For my Jetta.
Oh.
Where's
that going?
Yeah. I got to get a new car.
Yeah.
Anyway.
Increase
there's the recipe right
no,
there.
No, Doug pulled it up, but I don't think that's there. I'm texting Katrina as we speak right
well,
now.
Well, I'm going to read this one. The ingredients are, what is that? Three-fourths of a cup smooth almond butter. This is the almond
it
butter
has to
that
be smooth.
This is the almond butter that goes up to your girlfriend and says nice things.
Like, hey, girl.
Oh, yeah.
Then one cup of unsweetened applesauce.
Butter.
Half a cup of pure maple syrup. 1 tablespoon of pure vanilla extract. Half a cup of vegan chocolate chunks or chopped dark chocolate bar of 60-70% cacao. Half a cup of Organifi vanilla complete protein. Half a cup of unsweetened cocoa powder, 2 tablespoons of coconut flour, 1 teaspoon of baking soda, 1/2 teaspoon of fine sea salt, and 1/4 cup dark chocolate chunks that you sprinkle on the top. That sounds delicious. I could have all that.
I think we might have tried this one. I think the
what's
one
vegan chocolate? It looks like chocolate but tastes like soy.
It's chocolate that that talks to you about the environment and how it's better than
you,
the other
tells
chocolate.
Tells you what an asshole you are.
All the time.
Okay.
All the time. That's
I was
how
just
you know.
Wondering.
That's how you absolutely know. That looks pretty good, though.
Yeah,
that one does look. But that one is not the one we do because the one we do actually has a banana as banana and walnuts in it. Which again, I'm trying to get the queen here to respond to me and find out if it was something that she took that recipe and then she tweaked it for her own, or she actually found. Because normally, what we do is we.
I want to know what the macros are too.
This is one. Let me tell you something too. By the way, if you're not, you guys are not taking advantage of this. One of my favorite things about Organifi is that they do provide a ton of really cool recipes, and we're constantly using. I try to share with you guys the ones I really like. We try some stuff, and we're kind of like,
actually, this is a good time too because the holidays are
yes,
coming.
Yes, yes, it's a great
so
alternative
time to get so up, to this, trick your family and eating healthy.
We have we have my Thanksgiving coming up next weekend with my family, and the, and you, my mom texts Katrina. Katrina says, "Hey, Tammy, is there any side dishes that I could bring?" And she goes, "Yeah, could you bring the marshmallow jello salad?" And
Katrina, oh my God!
Katrina's like, she's like, what
"That's
the-?
Not just my family."
No, she goes, "What the fuck is this?"
Yeah,
like, we're not bringing.
Why
this
do they call it salad?
It's just, not salad.
It's not a salad. There's nothing salad about it. You use green jello. That's why
marshmallows.
That's why it's a salad. It's fucking using green.
You know what I mean?
It's awful, too. It is so awful. It's nothing. It is literally, it's awful.
You ever had a marshmallow tree?
Oh my God!
It's like, hey, try my new broccoli.
Somebody nutrients.
She's like, am I supposed to make this for your family? I'm like, no, we are not making that. We were making our own. Man. So we started playing around. So we're going to bring the
all these casseroles, these brownies,
because these brownies
like,
are awesome. So those that are listening, if you, you try the recipe that Sal said before the day is up, I will get it from Katrina. And then probably by the time this airs, I will have already.
In the show notes.
No.
What?
On the show notes?
Why not?
Well, because I don't know when this is. When is this going, Doug? This one goes when?
It doesn't matter. It's next week. Who cares?
Okay. Well, then maybe I can get it in there by that time. You gotta remind me.
Oh, it's my responsibility.
Oh my God.
Well, if you're gonna
never gonna happen then.
Well, if you're gonna put something like that out there and make hold me accountable, remember, I'm already the guy who's making the goddamn recipes and fucking trying them out and talking about them.
Hold
like,
on a second. Hold on a second. You're not. Your girlfriend is.
That's the same thing. We're one.
Text Katrina to remind
our relationship.
Text Katrina to put it in the show notes.
We are one
flesh.
Yeah, we are one.
you're winning points left and right.
Wow.
Part of when you find your partner forever, you're allowed to make claims that it's you when it's really your partner.
Yeah,
this is part of the perks.
That's awesome.
It is part of the perks, right?
Mm-hmm.
You don't do you, Justin. You don't do this.
I mean, sometimes I express
when your
that.
Wife does really good stuff, you don't take the credit for it.
Just take it. Yeah. It's just so like opposite of me, so I usually can't. You know what I mean? Nobody will believe me.
Well, dude, you guys have seen my how good I am on the silks when I used to travel with the Cirque du Soleil. My flexibility is incredible.
Yeah, you are.
Well,
man,
you know what? You know what I've what
you're
I
graceful.
Did, and Katrina called me out on this the other day because we were all somewhere. And
what are you telling people? You're organized?
No.
Okay. We are organized.
No, that I am not. That I am not, and I don't even try and claim that. But I've been on my own as a kid. I was out by 17, right? So I had to figure out, and from 17 all the way till I have the superwoman now in my 30s, you know, I had to do all my stuff myself as far as cooking and preparing, and I actually can cook pretty well, but I don't like it as well as I can cook. I don't enjoy it. So when we first started dating, and Katrina's gonna put me on blast for this one, but she's not a good cook. She wasn't a good
cook.
Oh no.
She was not. But
Katrina, I've had food that you've prepared. I think it's really good.
Oh no.
Yeah,
Katrina,
you're a good cook.
No.
Katrina, actually.
Bro, now
really good.
Trying to cover her.
Now she's one of the best cooks I've ever.
So she was bad.
Yeah. So what I would do, right? So I would make dinner, but then I would show her like, I really like this dish, and kind of show her like that, right? So, and now she looks back and she's just like, you know, I got totally bamboozled here because when we first started dating, you were making all these dinners. Meanwhile, what you were really doing was teaching me how to cook the shit that you want me to cook for you, because now you don't cook anything.
Dude, you know what I did the first time I made food? Because I don't mind cooking. I don't know much about it. And the way I eat is very simple anyway. I eat very plain and simple. So when I first started dating Jessica, I told her, I said, hey, I'll make you some lamb, some ground lamb and some vegetables. She's like, oh, that sounds awesome. So I had this, it was called a rocket grill. It's kind of like a George Foreman, except it's vertical. Yeah.
Dude, Foreman like saved my life. Yeah. That was all I cooked with.
So what I do is I buy ground lamb and I smash it. And I grill it. And that's it. You get this big patty of lamb in front of you with some vegetables on the side. And she's like, what else? Like, this is it? I'm like, yes, this is your meat.
That's so the bodybuilder, single guy, take care of yourself.
Single,
like,
dude.
Oh, man. I don't know how many times. I'm with Justin, too, on that.
Dude, all I would do is barbecue in college for myself. Like, I literally would rotate the meats and then the veggies if I even did that back then.
Barbecued in the summer, Foreman grill in the winter. Yeah. That was exactly years of eating like that.
Just meat,
as you were right there.
Yeah.
Some meat.
a little seasoning.
And some steamed vegetables next to it.
Is it that Montreal seasoning saved my life so many times?
So clutch, though.
They thought of it for us.
I cooked your guys' steaks with that Montreal this last weekend.
You did, and you did a good job. And you put like a butter. You used to put some butter on it.
That was a little added bonus.
That
was good.
Did you guys like those?
You know what? Let's talk about that for a second. What a great time up at the
Pajaro
Dunes.
Oh, yeah.
What a great time. Man. We went up there, and we got real focused and did a lot of work.
Well, I just love that we can go somewhere else like that that's like a great scenery, but we're productive. Mm-hmm. You know, we're all like in the same place, like hustling, doing our thing.
Have you guys never been to Pajaro Dunes before?
No.
Nope.
So I live the closest.
It's like this secret area, which now it's not because I'm talking about, but it was like a secret area near Watsonville. You'd never expect it to be there because you're driving through like fields of like artichokes and stuff.
It's all agriculture.
But it's beaches are gorgeous. There's some beautiful houses out there.
Mm-hmm.
And I have a client who was a great friend of mine, and she had a townhouse that she owned there, and she used to let me use it all the time. So I go there And I'd go there with, you know, team members from my own my wellness facility. I went there a bunch of times. I went there at the time with my wife and kids. And it's just a special place. I did lots of meditating on the beach. I've seen dolphins out there in the ocean a couple times, a seal. Actually, me and Adam went for a walk on the beach early in the morning when everyone's sleeping because we wanted to connect. And as we were walking on the beach barefoot.
You guys are so cute.
We saw two strange things. One, we saw a washed up seal carcass.
Right.
Which is not super strange.
Not strange. Yeah.
And then
there's great whites.
And then like a deer.
Yeah.
A deer.
Like an eaten deer?
No, it was just washed up and antlers and everything.
On the beach.
Like on the beach, dude.
They must have drowned and got like washed
from
up.
From where?
I don't know.
Yeah, it was weird.
I don't know.
Really weird.
It was really weird. Yeah.
There's like some shark out there that's kinda eerie. A land shark.
Yeah. But anyway, I had a great time with you.
No, that was such a, you know, we should.
And the house we stayed in, what was that, man?
Cool, right?
It was cool, but it was on stilts.
It was.
It was on stilts. So every time Justin, especially when Justin walked because he's heavy, he'd shake the whole house.
I am. I got a lead foot.
Yeah. Taylor was super.
Yeah, lead butt.
Taylor was super excited about the house, dude.
I do.
Yeah.
Taylor liked it a lot.
We should tell our audience though, because I know that a lot of people are like, "Oh, all the forum is like talking right now. Like, oh shit, what are they creating now? What are they doing?" Well, to be completely honest and transparent, we are creating sales funnels to close people that aren't listening to the podcast already. So it's really not for you guys.
That's
it's
super transparent, Adam.
Wow.
Well, it is. It's what it is. It's exactly
Well, okay, hold on. First of all.
Oh, sugar. Go ahead. Sugar coating.
It's not about sugar coating.
The waters.
It's not about sugar coating. The reality is if you want to be effective at selling whatever you have, rule number one, have something good because otherwise it won't last very long. And number two, you better provide some value and you better do a good job communicating what you want to communicate. Those are the two rules, big rules in sales. So a lot of what we were doing up there was providing or creating written, really good written content.
Oh, a lot.
Because we don't have a ton of written content online. So if someone wants, you know, it's people who never listen to Mind Pump.
Solidifying our message in a way that people will be able to understand who we are, what we're about, like, relatively quickly.
Exactly. So if you're, you know, if you're online and you're looking for fitness information, never heard of Mind Pump, so you have nothing, you don't know anything about our podcast or about our YouTube channel, and you're looking up what's the best body part split to build muscle, one of our articles might pop up where we talk about the benefits of increased training frequency. Or if you're, you know, a woman and you're looking up and you're like, why can't I get my stomach to flatten after having children or whatever, we may have an article coming up that talks about training the transverse abdominis and techniques. And so it's good value, it's good content.
Right.
So there you go.
Yeah, not a new program. That's what everyone thought was going on.
Well, we have a new program though.
Yeah, there's some
we
stuff.
We do.
We're sitting on
you
it.
You still want to fish.
There it is.
This Quah is brought to you by Organifi. For those days you fall short on getting your organic veggies or whole food nutrition, Organifi fills the gap with laboratory-tested, certified organic superfoods to help give your health and performance the added edge. Try Organifi totally risk-free for 60 days by going to Organifi.com. That's Organifi.com. And use the coupon code MINDPUMP for 20% off at checkout.
First up, the health engineer. What are your thoughts about sleeping on the floor versus sleeping in a bed? Isn't it analogous to wearing a shoe versus barefoot walking?
Isn't that a great point the guy makes? It's a very good point.
Yeah.
It's a very, very good point.
And I've heard this before. I don't know what her name was on Joe Rogan, but she goes to that extreme because she's like a biomechanic specialist and her whole house is like no furniture. It's like all like hardwood and like the poor kids that have to grow up like this.
Well, think about it. It's okay. So if you wear comfortable shoes, like cushy, squishy shoes all the time to run and work out in, if you just all of a sudden go barefoot all the time, you're going to hurt yourself because you're used to the support or the crutch of the shoes. Your feet are atrophied. Your ankles are weak. Your body is basically acclimated to this device that called a shoe. So when you go barefoot all of a sudden, you're going to cause problems. This is true with the bed too. Like if you're like, oh, wow, I should sleep on the hard floor because I heard it's good for me. I promise if you do that right off the bat,
you're going to jack everything up.
You're going to get terrible sleep, which then is worse for your health than the potential benefits of sleeping on a hard floor.
Well, I mean, there's some differences here too. So let me, if you're laying flat on your back, sleeping on the bed, gravity's pushing down, which most people are going to have all this anterior issue, right? Because we do everything on the front, like so quad, hip flexor, everything's all dominant in the front. And if you lay flat on your back, gravity's pushing down this way. not so detrimental. Now, laying sideways or potentially on your stomach, and then you have this arch in your low back, gravity's pushing down on you that way, maybe a little bit more. So sleeping on your back on a comfortable bed is not the same as somebody walking around with cushioned shoes.
And that's, again, the way I want to think about it is, because it's a good point.
But it is a good point.
Have all these deviations.
I like where he's going here.
If you have all these
deviations. You're going to get no buy-in.
Right. Yeah, if you have all these deviations and probably if you have all these deviations in your posture and these issues, is it the hard floor that's the problem? No, right? It's your body that's a problem. And again, if we go back to evolution, humans did not evolve sleeping on beds. We evolved sleeping on probably leaves or hay or the floor. I mean, the ground. That's just grass and stuff like that. So there may be some benefits for it. Now, I've experienced this for a short period of time.
When you're in prison?
No. Yes, exactly. I wasn't much sleeping, though, let me tell you.
Time, man.
I kept one eye open.
Yeah, you got to.
Let me tell you, it wasn't the bed that was hurting you.
That's
keep clenched.
That was terrible.
Clench hard.
It was Tyrone. That's what it was.
One eye open, the other one closed shut.
Yeah,
No, you may not.
When I first got divorced, when I left, you know, first of all, divorce is very expensive. You know, my kids, I wanted them to stay in the home that they grew up in. So I took nothing, and I had this mentality of like super minimalist. So I ordered on Amazon this like Japanese mat. It's cushion, but it's not. It's like a flat pillow, but it's big. And that's what I slept on for, I don't know, like 5 months. I slept on that thing for 5 months, and I swear to God, I felt good. There were no problems. I slept perfectly fine. Now, granted, I don't typically have issues sleeping, and I don't have problems in bed anyway, but I felt really good sleeping on the floor, and it wasn't a problem. And I did it recently when my girlfriend's family came to visit, and we gave them our bed, like good hosts are supposed to do,
not
and I slept on the floor.
Not a bad idea for a single guy who's not banging out, but if you're going to be having sex, I just can't imagine bringing over somebody for your...
Great point.
Right?
I mean, I was waiting for that.
Right. I'm thinking to myself, think about this. Like, you're having sex, dude.
Come on, man. My knees hurt?
Yes, bro.
What are you going to do? Yeah, how are you going to work with that?
There's a lot of places you could have sex, dude, not just the bed.
Listen.
I should go on the couch.
I've learned how to use springs for a reason.
Are you kidding me?
They store the energy and help you.
It's the motion.
So if you're this guy who sleeps on the floor or your Japanese bed you're talking about, you mean to tell me that you have your date or your girl over and you're like, hey, honey, like I want to have sex. Well, we could go to the couch if we want to have sex.
Well, let's go stand up somewhere.
Let's go stand up.
That's lame.
Hey. Yeah. Sex standing up is not bad.
I mean,
if you're in a pinch and you're in like
you got kids, bro.
Like an alley or something.
Yeah.
Hey, that's weird.
That's gross.
You're not selling me on this idea.
No, but it's interesting. I'm gonna look up the science on this because I feel like if you're healthy and fit, I feel like every once in a while sleeping under different circumstances and conditions may be good for the body, like changing up a lot of things.
Of course,
And here's the deal. I have family that served in the military, and they'll tell me that they learned to sleep pretty much anywhere, and now they have no issue sleeping because of that. And so I'm wondering if you...
Because
in the military, you don't get the most comfortable...
No, I get it, but I'm like trying to figure out what's the learning curve or what's the process.
Because you just do it. Like, if you had to sleep on the floor, and you would eventually learn how to sleep well on the floor... That might be a good skill. Now, when you go to a hotel, you sleep on your friend's couch or whatever, it's not an issue. Because I know a lot of people.
Why do we give these guys in prisons even a bed?
Yeah. Huh?
They should just get concrete slabs.
Maybe.
That's well, I mean, right there, I could probably save.
Let's go full inhumane. Let's go all in.
We're over here trying to make the argument that it's better for you. Yeah. I mean, if it's better for you, what the fuck are we doing giving inmates cushiony beds, dude?
I don't think they're getting cushiony beds.
Yeah, those assholes.
Yeah, I don't think so. No, I think.
Oh, I'm sure there's at least $1 million in these beds all over prisons.
That's not the way you save money with prisons. Not by taking away their beds.
Well, yeah, then we let out all the people that are in there for having a pound of marijuana on them.
Yeah, there you go.
Those two.
No, I think it's interesting. It may help. Look, I know people. I know a lot of people where if they're at a hotel or if they're camping or if they're anywhere other than their fucking room and bed, they can't sleep. That's not good. Yeah. That's not a good thing because then when you travel and stuff, you can't enjoy it. So it might be a good idea. I'm going to do some research on this because I bet you there's some
There's some truth,
compelling arguments.
You don't even have to do research on it, and you can make the argument that there is definitely some truth to that. And mm-hmm. I think a lot of it has to do with the gravity and your posture and your imbalances than anything else. Because if you're in this big cushiony bed, and you've got really bad posture, and then you sleep on your side or your stomach, you're not helping that whatsoever. Now, if you sleep on the floor, literally. I don't know anybody that could do that without sleeping on your back. You would have to sleep on your back, which
you're not sleeping on your side.
Right. You're not sleeping on your side. You're probably not sleeping on your face down.
I'm a side sleeper, dude, so this does not sound appealing.
Right. So you're sleeping on your back, and when you're laying on your back, it's the opposing gravity is probably the opposite of, or is probably what most people need, okay? Because if you think about laying on your back, most people have upper and lower cross syndrome, which is everything is rolled forward. So if you're laying flat on your back, gravity's pushing down, which is helping that condition versus making it worse. If somebody's in a bed that's all cushiony and soft, it's not really doing that, right? You're just absorbing it into the cushion, and you're going to keep the poor posture.
Potentially.
So I can make the argument on that, but
I sleep on a bed of nails. Man. Like a man.
Next up, healthy, happy, and free. How do you respond to the health at every size movement?
I think if we had to give away a gift for somebody who has given the best questions for the last year. Yeah.
Well, that's why you keep seeing them.
Healthy, happy, and free. Yeah. You win
a lot.
You are a frequent flyer.
Would you like?
Let's
a free
give
t-shirt?
Her some miles.
Let's give her a t-shirt.
And we don't even personally know this person. But when you ask good fucking questions, we can't avoid them.
We respond.
We try and avoid people. We see the names of a lot to give a nice rotation for everybody. But sometimes some of you guys are just
quality
smart motherfuckers.
Hey, DM one of us. We'll send you a free t-shirt. Actually, speaking of gifts, because we're getting near the holiday season. And you talked about, I don't know which episode you talked about, but you talked about how you do where you adopt a family and you give them a gift and stuff like that.
Yes.
So something that we don't talk a lot about, and I want to bring this up before I answer this question, with Thrive Market, one of our sponsors, one of the things that they do that I really, really, really like is when you get a membership with them, you know, you get their good prices, you get their good products, their fast shipping, all that stuff, but they will donate a free membership to a family in need.
Dude, how cool would it be if we did how could we do that, right? If everybody was like, we made a push on Thrive Market right now to try and get a family in need
for free. It used to be, yeah. I mean, these days, if you're...
You should look into that.
If you have issues with money, if you're, you know, if you're a single parent household or whatever, your nutrition tends to be much, much, much worse. Mm-hmm. Part of it is just accessibility, mm-hmm. and part of it's convenience, and part of it's cost. It's actually can be more expensive to eat healthy. So what I like about this particular, our sponsor, Thrive Market, is you get a membership, they'll donate a membership to a person in need. The CEO, who we did an episode with, what's his name, Gunner?
Mm-hmm.
I think his name was Gunner. He grew up very poor. And this is why he implemented this. So it's phenomenal. It's a great time of year to do this. So mm-hmm. check it out. Okay,
that in itself is a reason to try Thrive Market. So if you haven't tried Thrive Market, like for whatever reason that's keeping you from doing that, considering that you can shop whole organic foods at your door within 2 days for the price that you would pay at a Safeway for regular food that's not organic. Just doing it for the simple fact that you're helping out a family in need, I think is a cool thing to do.
It's best time of year to do it.
At this time of the year.
Best time of year to do it.
Great point, dude.
So the question was, how do we respond to the health at every size movement? So here's the thing I want you to do, if you're listening to the show right now, I want you to kind of slow down for a second, close your eyes, and imagine yourself at a very healthy state. And what I mean by healthy is you're balanced. You have a healthy mental state, healthy physical state.
Yes.
You know, you just, everything.
All factors combined.
All factors combined. All are very healthy and optimal. Now, what does the physical representation of that look like? Mm-hmm. Now, I can tell you right now, the physical representation of that being in health does not look like obesity. Mm. It does not look like you're super heavy. It does not look like inflammation. It does not look like gut health issues. It does not look like depression. It doesn't look like any of that stuff. So the health at every size movement, I think, is rooted in very, very good intentions. Yeah. But I think people
from the psychological aspect of it alone.
Yes, because I think people are taking it to mean, I know I'm 80 pounds overweight. I don't care because I'm still healthy. Yeah. That's not entirely true. Now, Can you be 80 pounds overweight and then compound that with a super negative self-image where you confuse your body image with your self-image?
Right, right.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. And that's not going to help you. It's not going to help you at all. It's not going to help you even if you lose weight, even if you're at the right weight, even if physically you look healthy, but you have this terrible self-image, that's also not healthy. So health at every size really is rooted in the love yourself, don't hate yourself, which I believe
you can love
fully
your,
in.
You can love yourself at any size,
yes.
Right? And you can love yourself at any size, but still accept that I'm not the healthiest version of myself.
That's right. Mm-hmm.
And that's what it, that's really, and that's why I,
that's body image.
Well, you want to be objective too.
Well, this is why I don't like this movement, because it's rooted with the right idea, right? That, like you said, having the, helping people disconnect self from body image. But what happens with it, it ends up turning into this thing of justifying or making an excuse to not take care of yourself, because I can love myself even though I'm 100 pounds.
I will give you a great example of this, okay? Because obesity is much more common nowadays, it's becoming cool to say negative things about people who are skinny, in particular with women. There's whole songs talking about, you know, men don't want no skinny girl, or, you know, the guys like, you know, women with, you know, with meat on them, whatever. There's a lot of women in there out there that are naturally skinny that you're going to potentially cause bad body image and self-image with them as well. So that's the negative side of this. You know what I'm saying? That there's a negative side to this health at every size movement. I don't think it's the movement itself. I think it's the people in it who pervert the movement and who are, because they feel bad about themselves, in order to make themselves feel better, they're going to make you feel bad because you're skinny,
right, right.
Or make you feel bad because you don't have a big butt or whatever. Yeah. The reality is, when you're truly healthy on all aspects, the physical representation of that looks very fit. It does. Now, you not extreme. It doesn't look extreme, so you're not going to look like a bodybuilder.
Well, I was just going to say, it's no different than where I was at when I was competing. When I get on stage, I would be a fool if I said I'm the healthiest I've ever been in my life.
Right. That wasn't a physical representation of health for you.
Right. It wasn't. It's not the healthiest I've ever been.
It's extreme, and that's the thing. Like, you're not going to look like a bodybuilder. You're not going to be a shredded athlete. You're not going to be extreme, but you are going to be fit. Mm-hmm. You are going to be relatively lean. So right. For women, this means you'll probably be in the high teens to low 20s in terms of body fat, probably. Everybody's a little different. For men, you're going to be anywhere between 8 to maybe 13% body fat, although, of course, there are some individual variances. You're going to have a good amount of strength. You're not going to be like super powerlifter of the year, but you're going to be strong enough to perform squats and deadlifts and maybe do some pull-ups, and you're going to be able to get up and move and run and play with your kids. You're going to feel fantastic, and you're going to look really good. You're going to look probably the best that you've ever looked, because a lot of people don't ever really get to this part, to the stage, you know?
Right. Yeah, and it's, I mean, it's interesting because it starts out on the right foot, right? Because this has to be a bit of backlash from all the magazine covers and all the
totally, that's exactly what it is.
You know, all the vanity that's just completely highlighted, that is the extreme, and that's what people identify as health. And I think that's the unfortunate part, is a lot of times people feel just like that's unattainable. Well, so therefore I have to just love myself where I am, and then they just get stuck in that one operating mode.
Leave it to us in our society to go from one side to the other side. We were just 20 years ago, we were idolizing, you know, these models that were unhealthy, rail thin, to the point where they were
just starving,
doing drugs, starving themselves, throwing up to look this way. And we idolized them for many years on covers of magazines. Now we're going the complete opposite direction, where we're saying, oh, bigger is better, and this is healthier, and this is, and then you have the other extreme now, where it's like, oh, love yourself even though you're 100 pounds overweight, which is true. You should love yourself, but to fool yourself and to think that you're healthy is wrong. It's not true. Just as no different than it was for the skinny bitch who's doing cocaine and throwing up, saying that she's healthy. You know, no. The way we look on the outside is not a necessarily mean that you're not healthy, and it necessarily doesn't mean you are either. So both are true. So it's like this movement, we just went from one extreme to the other. Hopefully we'll find somewhere in the middle in the next like 10 to 15 years.
Yeah, I think you know, body acceptance and, you know, health at every size, I mean, really, it just means this, like, don't hate yourself, even if you physically...
Yeah, it's like step one.
Yeah, don't hate yourself, just because, okay, fine, you're 100 pounds overweight, 50 pounds overweight, you're out of shape, whatever. That doesn't mean you don't hate yourself. It doesn't mean you're a bad person. It doesn't even mean you're fat. You're not that. Your body may have body fat on it, but that's not who you are. So recognize that. And that's really the first step to becoming healthy anyway. Because once you understand that, then you can make the choices and decisions that are geared around true, you know, health at every size, true body acceptance, true love for yourself. And then you'll find that your physical representation will manifest, you know, that'll reflect that. Like, I'll never forget, there was this female client that we had at one of the gyms that I managed years ago, and she was 65 years old, and I only know her age because I asked her at one point, because she'd come in, we'd talk and whatever. She had long, you know, gray hair. It was gorgeous, gorgeous hair. She didn't dye her hair. She never wore any makeup. She wasn't extreme in one way or the other, but she was, you know, relatively toned, had great movement. She would sometimes come in and do yoga. Sometimes she'd lift weights. Always had this great attitude. And all the guys in the gym, and, you know, mind you, we're all in our 20s at this point. All of us would comment on, like, how sexy this woman was. Like, wow, this woman is really attractive. And she's, you know, a lot older than we are. And one day I approached her because we were hanging out and talking. I told her that. I said, man, I said, I'm going to be honest with you. I said, all the guys in here always comment over how attractive you are. And I said, and, you know, she kind of blushed and she's like, thanks. And I said, no, it's, I said, it's a true compliment because you're beautiful in the real sense. You emanate this kind of, you know, this true health and beauty. I said, if you don't mind me asking, how old are you? And I fully expected her to say she was something like 48 or 50, 65 years old. Completely blew me away. So I started asking her about nutrition. And I was expecting her to be like, oh, I eat, you know, six, you know, chicken breasts a day and I eat this, that. Yeah. No. She's like, I just listen to my body. Sometimes I train hard, sometimes I train easy, depending on how I feel. She's like, I just really learned. She goes, years ago I had a horrible body image. And years ago I just started really caring for myself. And she's like, the irony is I look better than I ever have. She's like, but I don't even notice now because it's not a big deal. It totally stuck with me back then. Mm-hmm. And it's later on that kind of surfaced, that memory, when I had my own, you know, journey with nutrition. So hope some people take away some stuff from that.
Next question is from Tony Lowe, yo, yo, yo.
Oh, that's our boy.
He was at our seminar.
Yo, yo, yo.
What's up, Tony?
What's up, Tom?
He's asking, should he stay a trainer or manage a big box gym?
Oh, wow.
That's a good question. It depends, man.
Decisions.
If you love training clients and that's your passion, then you're going to have to stay a trainer. And if you want to make more money, you're going to probably have to go private because the big boxes aren't going to pay much.
Do you
like leading people more than you like training people, which for me, I actually enjoyed it a little bit more than training people. I like to lead people a little more. Then I'd say go manage a big box gym. You could do pretty well and you learn a lot about business if you work for the right organization.
Well, the opportunities there, I mean, just to, even if you don't like leadership or you don't consider yourself like a great leader, what an experience that would be to grow.
Absolutely.
You know? So, I mean, for me, I would look at it like that. And then if you haven't done it before, like, you can always come back to personal training. But yeah, it's totally different. I mean, it's a night and day difference.
I don't even think it's a close call for me. I would for sure manage a big box gym, but that was all. But the thing with me was, I remember really early, I didn't like training clients as much as the average trainer that liked training clients did. I gravitated towards teaching others, and I love to teach trainers how to be better trainers. And so if you really, really love training clients and you have a true passion for it, rarely did I ever meet those trainers who ended up going on to be managers and really loving that. Normally the guys and girls that wanted to manage big box gyms or become leaders, they recognized that early on, and they saw that, like, that's what I right away, like, I knew, like, oh, I would be, as a trainer, I'd be training, but then after work hours, I'd be sitting around with the other trainers teaching them what I was doing. And I found myself doing that, not getting paid. And so to me, that was the sign that, okay, I really like doing this part where I'm mentoring these other trainers even more than I actually like doing the work, right?
Yeah.
So I think that is something you have to dig in deep.
I feel like this is a conundrum that good trainers at you know, these big box gyms, because there's a lot of trainers at these big box gyms, and let's be honest, the most of them, they're not going to be making, you know, fitness their career. A lot of them are doing it because they're going to school at the same time or because they like working out. Some of them are focused and dedicated and love it and then want to build a career in fitness. And at some point, if you're good and you're succeeding and you're one of the top trainers in your gym, you're facing this problem. Like, okay, now what? Because yeah. I'm not going to make enough money training clients at a 24 Fitness or a Crunch Fitness or an LA Fitness. So what do I do now? And your options are usually management and move up the ladder, or you got to go train private where you can charge more and start making more money.
Which is kind of what I did. But before that, you know, I flirted around with management and leadership, and I just found it to be a great training grounds for learning how to really refine what you teach, like not just to your clients, but now to other educated peers. And that's a whole nother skill set that you're going to carry with you going forward. So it's a no-brainer. Like, I definitely think that if you've never done that before, you're going to learn so much more about your current craft, and you're going to improve on it tremendously. So
now, that being said, the last 3 months of I did a year, about a year and a few months, I was a trainer, and then I was promoted. And then most of my career, I led trainers, right? So I was a manager running a big box gym like that with typically 15 to 25 trainers underneath me. And I did that for like 10 years. Now, the final 3 months before I left the company, I stepped down to be a trainer. And the reason why I did that was because that was like really easy for me compared to managing a big box. There's so many other things that that are different from being just a trainer between running a box. I mean, you're running P&Ls, you're paying attention to what everybody else is doing. There's a lot more responsibilities going that, which I loved, and I liked doing that. But when I knew my mind was somewhere else, like I had my own personal goals and I was building other businesses, that it, being just a trainer was really easy because I could be, I could put half my effort into being a trainer, and I still felt that I could do it better than most everybody around me, relieved me of some of my time and allowed me to spend more time in other businesses to grow that where my head kind of headspace was. So I know Tony, and I know that we talked when you were here, and if you have aspirations of doing other things that are not related to being a trainer or a big box gym, being a trainer is nice because you can still make a good income and you can still focus on the other things you're doing. You step into a big box gym, good luck trying to do
that's going
to
consume you.
Yeah. If you're going to be successful at it, right?
There's a lot. Listen, running a big gym requires a lot of time, a lot of effort, and a lot of skill.
Yep.
It's not easy. In fact, some of the best general managers I've ever known throughout my career in the big box gyms, they left fitness and are extremely successful in other areas of business. And it's all from the skills that they learn running these big box gyms. So like Adam said, if you're going to do that, that's pretty much what you're going to do. You can't do anything else while you're doing it.
Next question is from 500 Days of Fuck You.
another top question. It's been a while since we've seen this one.
So how is it possible to be vegan and have a bigger ass than Justin?
That's not possible. that ass is fully built on meat, dude.
That's
a carnivore's ass.
We don't even call Justin's ass an ass. We call it cakes.
Yeah.
Because
there's layers.
It's like
you can celebrate birthdays on it.
There's a lot of calories in there.
Right.
You know, all that kind and of stuff. It's soft and firm at the same time. So so here's the thing. It's funny. This question's funny, but also it's kind of interesting because people ask, can you build muscle as a vegan? Absolutely. You absolutely can. If you have a well-planned diet, you know, Bill Pearl had this conversation with Arnold Schwarzenegger years ago. Because Arnold was under the impression that you couldn't, and got in this huge debate, and Bill Pearl is a freaking beast, and he did it on a vegan diet. You just have to be more structured and more, it takes more planning than an omnivore diet because there are nutrients you're going to have to seek out that tend to be easier to find with me. And there are certain things that you can't find in just a vegan diet, like creatine. Although your body can synthesize creatine, it's typically not enough. So if you're a vegan, you're going to benefit much more from supplementing with creatine than even the average
person. It's kind of like learning how to ride a bike blind. Like, you can do it, you know, but it's a lot easier if you could see, right? It's kind of like that. It's possible both ways. It's a little bit more challenging for somebody that is a vegan to do that. But yeah, no, absolutely. Honestly, where I see the biggest disconnect with people trying to build an ass is less about the nutrients. It's not their
neurological connection.
Yes, it's for sure. In fact, I'm going to shoot a video today, which hopefully will release or be ready around this time this comes out. So pay attention to Mind Pump TV that talks just about this. And I'm going to share a YouTube about, you know, what I came across in my career. Almost everybody who was trying to build a butt, what was going wrong? And the answer is nothing to do with vegan or protein or anything like that. It has everything to do with what Justin just alluded to, which was the neurological disconnect and becoming very quad anterior dominant, and they just do not have to connect to their posterior chain.
So in other words, these are people, and there's a lot of them, when they do the best quote-unquote butt-building exercises, squats, lunges, you know, they're doing their Bulgarian split squats, you know, all these movements, deadlifts, that are really good for the glutes, they're so dominant with the other muscles, like their quadriceps, that the glutes aren't really getting everything they can get out of the exercise. So the result is, you know, these people who are doing lots of squats, lots of lunges, lots of all these exercises, and their quads are growing, they're getting results everywhere else, and yet their butt simply won't respond. And this has everything to do with what's called a recruitment pattern. It has to do with how the muscles fire. And so when you are squatting, you have your quads, your hamstrings, and your glutes, which are the main movers. You can definitely get in a position where the glutes aren't doing nearly as much work as they could be doing. And how you prime your body before your workouts makes a massive difference.
Yeah.
Also, how you connect to your glutes. And it's much more complicated than just do these movements to get your glutes to fire. It's also learning how to connect your glutes. It's that intention with the movements. We actually talk about this in our butt builder bundle, right?
Yeah, and it's also just the biomechanics. It's taking that time to really focus on increasing depth in your squat, let's say. So that's something where we can now get into a position where we're allowing the glutes to you know, stretch to their full capacity and now contract at their full capacity.
Listen, almost everybody, especially if you're above 25 and older, almost everybody is suffering from some sort of a lower cross syndrome and or upper cross syndrome, normally both. And it's very similar to the upper cross with the issues that people have with a bench press, that it's just people have a hard time connecting that you would have the same problem with the butt, right? So I know most people listening to this have heard of or dealt with themselves. The first time you get under to do like a barbell press and you feel it all in your shoulders and your arms and you don't really feel much in your chest, that is the same problem that a person who is squatting who doesn't feel it in their butt is having, only it's down below lower cross syndrome. Is there everything is so anterior driven. They go to do a squat, which should be posterior driven, but guess what? Your anterior, so the front of your body, can take over, and it does because it's more dominant. You've trained it that way. Same thing, someone goes into a bench press, we're so rounded forward that our shoulders and our arms take over the movement that we can't get ourselves in this retracted position to actually activate the bigger, stronger muscle that should be moving.
You literally can do the same exercise one way and do it another way and almost be, people can watch, unless you have a trained eye, like I can watch someone do an exercise one way or another way with subtle changes and I can tell what's firing more. But to the average person, you can watch a squat from someone doing it one way and doing it another way, and the changes are so subtle that it looks the same, but doing it one way, we get way more glute activation. Doing it the other way, they're getting more quad activation. So if you're one of these people where you're not feeling like you're getting the results in your glutes like you want to, you're not developing the round, full glutes from doing those great exercises, then we do have some videos on connecting to your glutes on our channel, YouTube channel, Mind Pump TV. Those are free. But we also have a Build Your Butt bundle, which includes a program specifically designed for your body to train, but also there's a modification in there that teaches you movements to prime and train your body so that your glutes do fire better when you do these exercises. So I believe the Build Your Butt bundle combines what? MAPS Anabolic and MAPS Aesthetic, right?
Yes.
So it combines the two, puts the mod in there, discounts everything, and the results are pretty phenomenal. Also, go to the YouTube channel, Mind Pump TV. There's the free videos there. Subscribe to that channel. There's 365 videos a year. That's a lot more than most people, and we're going to keep doing that. We might even increase that. Also, if you go to mindpumpmedia.com, you can find the Build Your Butt Bundle, and you can also enroll in 30 days of coaching, which is absolutely for free.
Thank you for listening to Mind Pump. If your goal is to build and shape your body, dramatically improve your health and energy, and maximize your overall performance, check out our discounted RGB Super Bundle at mindpumpmedia.com. The RGB Super Bundle includes MAPS Anabolic, MAPS Performance, and MAPS Aesthetic, 9 months of phased expert exercise programming designed by Sal, Adam, and Justin to systematically transform the way your body looks, feels, and performs. With detailed workout blueprints and over 200 videos, the RGB Super Bundle is like having Sal, Adam, and Justin as your own personal trainers, but at a fraction of the price. The RGB Super Bundle has a full 30-day money-back guarantee, and you can get it now plus other valuable free resources at mindpumpmedia.com. If you enjoy this show, please share the love by leaving us a 5-star rating and review on iTunes and by introducing Mind Pump to your friends and family. We thank you for your support, and until next time, this is Mind Pump.